Untamed by Max Brand. Introduction. This was the first effort by Frederick Faust aimed at writing a Western, and he used the pen name of Max Brand to produce it. There was a different style of literary focus, a variance that brought forth feelings of melodrama. However, as the story developed, that impression was changed drastically, because there were certainly startling examples of action, conflict, and revenge that set it apart. It was marked one of his most successful efforts in a career that produced perhaps as many as 25 to 30 million words, resulting in well more than 500 novels and short stories. This huge output made him one of the most prolific writers in history, and he wrote under at least a dozen pen names, with Max Brand as the most prominent. What made it more astonishing is that he died at age 51, after being mortally wounded by shrapnel while serving as a war correspondent in World War II. Listen now to what made literary history. Chapter 1, Pen of the Desert. Even to a high-flying bird, this was a country to be passed over quickly. It was burned and brown, littered with fragments of rock, whether vast or small, as if the refuse were tossed here after the making of the world. A passing shower drenched the bald knobs of a range of granite hills, and the slant morning sun set the wet rocks aflame with light. In a short time the hills lost their halo and resumed their brown. The moisture evaporated. The sun rose higher and looked sternly across the desert, as if he searched for any remaining life which still struggled for existence under his burning course. And he found life. Hardy cattle moved singly or in small groups and browsed on the withered bunch grass. Summer scorched them, winter humped their backs with cold and arched up their bodies with famine. But they were a breed schooled through generations for this fight against nature. In this junk shop of the world, rattlesnakes were rulers of the soil. Overhead, the buzzards, ominous black specks pendant against the white-hot sky, ruled the air. It seemed impossible that human beings could live in this rock wilderness. If so, they must be to other men what the lean, hardy cattle of the hills are to the corn-fed stable beeves of the States. Over the shoulder of a hill came a whistling which might have been attributed to the wind, had not this day been deathly calm. It was fit music for such a scene, for it seemed neither of heaven nor earth, but the soul of the great god Pan come back to earth to charm those nameless rocks with his wild, sweet piping. It changed to harmonious phrases loosely connected. Such might be the exultant improvisations of a master violinist. A great wolf, or a dog, as tall and rough-coated as a wolf, trotted around the hillside. He paused with one foot lifted and lolling crimson tongue as he scanned the distance and then turned to look back in the direction from which he had come. The weird music changed to whistled notes as liquid as a flute. The sound drew closer. A horseman rode out on the shoulder and checked his mount. One could not choose him at first glance as a type of those who fight nature in a region where the thermometer moves through a scale of 160 degrees in the year to an accompaniment of cold, stabbing winds and sweltering suns. A thin, handsome face with large brown eyes and black hair, a body tall but rather slenderly made, he might have been a descendant of some ancient family of Norman nobility. But could such proud gentry be found riding the desert in a tall-crowned sombrero with chaps on his legs and a red bandana handkerchief knotted around his throat? That first glance made the rider seem strangely out of place in such surroundings. One might even smile at the contrast, but at the second glance the smile would fade, and at the third it would be replaced with a stare of interest. It was impossible to tell why one respected this man, but after a time there grew a suspicion of unknown strength in this lone rider, strength like that of a machine which is stopped but only needs a spark of fire to plunge it into irresistible action. Strangely enough, the youthful figure seemed in tune with that region of mighty distances, with that white, cruel sun, with that bird of prey hovering high, high in the air. It required some study to guess at these qualities of the rider, for they were such things as a child feels more readily than a grown man, but it needed no expert to admire the horse he bestrode. It was a statue in black marble, a steed fit for a Shah of Persia. The stallion stood barely 15 hands, but to see him was to forget his size. His flanks shimmered like satin in the sun. What promise of power in the smooth, broad hips! Only an Arab poet could run his hand over that shoulder and then speak properly of the matchless curve. Only an Arab could appreciate legs like thin and carefully drawn steel below the knees, or that flow of tail and windy mane, that generous breast with promise of the mighty heart within, that arch neck, that proud head with the pricking ears, wide forehead and muzzle, as the sheikh said, which might drink from a pint pot. A rustling like dried leaves came from among the rocks, and the hair rose bristling around the neck of the wolf-like dog. With outstretched head, he approached the rocks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.